Max, can you hear us? Just give me a thumbs up. You good?
Yeah.
All right.
Perfectly.
Yep. Perfect. You're going to give some remarks, right? Are you opening it up? Okay, I'll give that to you.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is a pleasure in my condition as Director General for ICA, give all of you a warm welcome. This House of Sustainable Agriculture of the Americas represents the spirit of this continent, a very heterogeneous one, but has decided to be united in order to present our situation and our aspirations as a ranchers, farmers in this continent. During the session today, someone said, don't blame the cows, don't blame the ranchers, The only way is to increase productivity, to be more efficient. It's the only way, the only way. And we are ready to cope with this general objective. I would like to say that for ICA, it's an honor to be part of the Protein Pact. And I would like to recognize the leadership of the North America Meat Institute and the National Pork Board. So thank you very much. Also, I would like to recognize the presence of the Minister of the Livestock, Agriculture and Fisheries of the Uruguay, people from Argentina. So for us, it's very important this session. So having said that, I return the mic. Thank you.
Well, thank you. And thank you for kicking us off. So my name is Ashley McDonald. I'm the Interim Vice President of Sustainability at the National Pork Board. Hopefully you can hear me. I'll try to hold this up a little bit. But welcome to this session. And there are too few of these sessions here at COP27 focused on one, food, and then also focused specifically on livestock. So this one's called, you know, we titled it Sustainable Livestock Around the World, and we are going to look at livestock systems across different geographies as well as different production system types and talk about their contributions as one of the key contributors to providing climate solutions, because that's why we're all here, of course, is to implement these solutions. And we know that livestock can be that important contributor to the climate and the climate solution. So with that, I am just thankful that the three folks here could be with us, as well as Max, who you can see up here on the camera. Max, he's gonna be our last speaker, and then we'll open it up for questions. But today, and I think we have, if you wanna transition the slide, somebody walked off with our clicker, so we are going to make do by saying next. but so you can see, so you can see our panelists up here today on the screen. Sorry, Laura, they're right behind you. But Bill Hohenstein with the U.S. Department of Agriculture, Laura Kramer with the International Livestock Research Institute, Gianni Mata with National Meat Institute of Uruguay. And then again, up on the screen here, you can see Max Mukwege with the Shang'ani Holistic and with the Global Roundtable for Sustainable Beef. So again, thank you all for being here. This is an extremely important topic. And I think we're going to start off with a video. So if we can hopefully get this to work.
Our Protein Pact puts animal agriculture's clear vision. Based reporting verifies progress and keeps us accountable for contributing to global goals. We are committed to continuously improve how we make food with a more positive environmental impact than ever. And further achievements are within reach. Protecting natural resources, supporting farmers' livelihoods, providing good jobs, and making food that families around the world rely on every day. Our commitments are targets and ambitious. For example, to contribute to global climate goals, U.S. pork will reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 40% by 2030. From farms to food service and retail, the U.S. beef value chain aims for climate neutrality by 2040. U.S. dairy has the need to achieve greenhouse gas neutrality or better by 2050. And 100% of the North American Meat Institute's members will have an emissions reduction target approved by the Science-Based Targets Initiative by 2030. While working to optimize their environmental impacts, Protein Pact partners are continuing to produce more of the nutrient-dense meat, dairy, and eggs the world needs. Meat, dairy, and eggs are the best and sometimes only source of essential nutrients, too often not being consumed globally, in countries at all income levels. Protein Pact partners are transparently measuring baselines and verifying progress across animal agriculture. For example, the North American Meat Institute has created the first ever data set for meat companies to report on meat nutrient continuous improvement metrics. Data collected in 2022 powers an estimated 90% of meat sold in the United States. And by 2030, 100% of Meat Institute members will report on all metrics.
The culture shift that we are undertaking right now, and we've just begun it this year for the first time, is collecting data from our members and having proof of the journey that we're on, and hopefully the success over the long term.
So total information, total transparency, that's the first feedback.
We have our own individual stories that we like to share. Having this whole organization and this whole industry, putting it out there. If you added up everything that all the companies, a lot of people that are sitting in this room have done, given back, and the impacts they've made, it would be mind-blowing. Our whole supply chain is engaged in this partnership. Mm-hmm. Looking at climate is huge for all of us, upstream and downstream. We're not alone. Mm-hmm. And so our producers that grow the animals, they're already doing more with us. Our processors, they're already increasing yield and making sure there's plenty with fewer inputs. Mm-hmm. So we have a lot that we have already been doing, a lot more than this. We do a ton of recycling. So we recycle cardboard, plastic, equipment. Mm-hmm. We don't need to keep track of that. So we decided to take a look at what we're currently doing. We'll have a way to stand on that.
Our vision is to minimize food waste and to build a more sustainable future by finding the best possible use for all available proteins globally. Personal vision for the future is to continue to meet the needs of the growing worldwide population. That's a challenge that's going to get even harder to meet in the future as the populations grow. But through being good stewards of the environment and of our products, we can continue to meet this need.
Protein is a staple to our diet, and there is a protein gap in the U.S. food banking system, about 500 million pounds by some estimates, according to Feeding America. People need to put their curiosity hats on and seek out ways that fit for them. What we're doing for us fits for Cargill, but there are companies that are just in one state or one city, and there are things that fit for them too that they can take on and just do on a local basis. This doesn't have to be something that is too big to handle.
This is what the consumers are looking for, both domestically and globally. They want to better understand how their food is raised, where it comes from, and what's happening with it. And the five pillars of the protein pack that NAMI has put together are exactly what we need in order to get that out.
As pork producers and we represent the farmers, we believe that you have to have principles in place that you believe in. You have to have practices, right, making it come to life on the farm. But then you also have to deliver proof that you're doing the things that you say you're going to do. And so that's one of the things that Protein Hack is looking at, is how do we take our principles as producers, put together our practices we take either in farms or in processing plants, and then how do you bring that proof forward to build public trust?
The U.S. pork industry is on a mission to be the most sustainable meat, and we're well on our way when you consider pork provides many nutrients of value in the diet with the most impact to the environment. From our animals to our products, the environment and our communities, and for the people who make our farms work. We are dedicated to making a positive and sustainable impact for all by doing what's right for people, kids, and the planet. What does sustainability look like here? Let's start with the pigs. Safe, nutritious, and sustainable food starts on the farm with healthy, well-cared-for animals. That's why we're committed to the highest level of care and well-being for the pigs we raise. By way of fully transparent certification programs, Pet Quality Assurance Plus, and documenting veterinary oversight. The environment around the farm is important too. We've made a lot of progress reducing land, water use, and natural resource use over the last 55 years, and we'll continue doing so while decreasing impacts on water and the air, because that's what our communities deserve.
The U.S. Pork Checkoff pioneered and has funded on-farm sustainability reports that help pork producers measure and document continuous improvement efforts. More than 300 operations, representing more than 200,000 acres and 2 million pigs, have signed up so far. The U.S. Department of Agriculture recently awarded the National Pork Board and partners $20 million in Climate Smart grant funding to expand this effort, documenting and furthering adoption of soil health and manure management practices.
You have to be able to change. You have to be able to evolve. And continuous improvement for us really represents all of that. And you can't just talk about it at the level of, you know, kind of a moderate interest. You've got to live. What does it mean to be better every day for the people of our organization, for the industry as a whole, for the customers and the consumers we serve? Because they'll tell you pretty quickly if they don't believe you or if they don't see that as transparent and real. And so for us, that's really how we always approach it.
You may accomplish something today, but really that is not going to be all that you need to accomplish. You're going to need to go further on, because the problems evolve and the problems grow. The opportunities evolve and the opportunities grow.
Like we have for centuries, people are relying on animals for food we need to thrive. And now we are galvanizing everyone, making meat, dairy, and eggs to do so in a way that sustains generations to come. That's why we've made this path, to provide delicious, nutritious food for our families, support livelihoods for farmers and good jobs around the world, while providing the best care for every animal and protecting the land, water, and air we all share. To learn more about our Protein Pact for the People, Animals, and the Climate of Tomorrow, visit theproteinpact.org.
Well, so yeah, thankfully I get to have a video, so I don't have to have as many slides, which is always helpful. But you heard a lot about the pork industry, the U.S. pork industry, and of course, National Pork Board represents 66,000 pig farmers in the United States. And, you know, our job is to provide research, education to promote our pork products and make them more sustainable over time, to be able to promote them both domestically as well as globally. And so that's what my team at the Pork Board does on a daily basis, because we know that ultimately we have to do what's right for people, pigs, and the planet to be able to have a consumer long term. And so I think one of the themes you heard there, and probably will hear maybe more about today, is that kind of that proof point. Right. For a very long time, we've talked about these things and we've made commitments, and I think we have finally crossed over into really having the research and the tools available to really start to document progress over time in a very scientific way. Now, I think it's very fitting to have this panel on Finance Day, because the last piece of that is how do you scale it further, right? How do you take those tools and make them available, get them implemented, get them used, and then ultimately make practice changes on the ground that make a difference, and you can share your story. And so that's what I'd say the Pork Board is dedicated to now more than ever. Our pig farmers are dedicated to that, and we're very, very proud to be a member of the Protein Pact to be able to share that story along with the other livestock in the States and around the globe, to be able to tell that story. So I say that the first panelist we're going to hear from, Bill Hohenstein with USDA, and he has probably a lot to talk about on Finance Day. Some really big announcements, one of which fairly recently, I guess 2 months ago now, but we previewed it on the video there, Climate Smart Partnerships. But want to hear what you your thoughts on kind of the sustainable livestock systems in general, obviously, particularly in the States. And then I want to hear more about what the secretary and you think about the partnerships and how far you think we can take those as a livestock system, as well as U.S. agriculture in general.
Sure. Thanks, Ashley. Again, it's a pleasure to be here. I'm Bill Hohenstein. I'm the director of USDA's Office of Energy and Environmental Policy. And our office covers and is responsible for climate change work within USDA, as well as environmental markets, including things like carbon offsets and energy policy, including things like biofuels and bioenergy and anaerobic digesters to produce energy. So we have quite a broad portfolio. And luckily, we have an amazing capacity within the Department of Agriculture in the US to both do the work, to conduct the research, to work on innovation, and to deliver that capacity to producers around the country. We have offices and agencies that are reflected in every one of the rural counties within the United States, and we have the capacity to broadly reach farmers across the US. We have a very ambitious climate agenda. And as we move forward, we want to share that. And so again, very happy to be here at AICA, part of our broader effort as we learn through doing. We're going to make a priority to take that information and to make it available globally. So I'm going to talk about four things, our work on mitigation, adaptation, innovation and research, and then international engagement. So, within our mitigation work, it falls within the broader US commitment to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, a very ambitious goal of reducing emissions by 50 to 52% by 2030, and ultimately achieving net zero greenhouse gas emissions by 2050. 2030 is 8 years away, 7 years away almost. And so we have our work to do. Luckily, we have the resources and the commitment to do this work. And Ashley mentioned the Partnerships for Climate Smart Commodities, which was a program launched by Secretary Vilsack earlier this year. He will be here on Saturday talking about this program, along with some of the members that are also part of the program, including, you know, it's good to see the Pork Board here as well, one of our partners. In addition, Congress passed the Inflation Reduction Act, which may not sound on its face to have anything to do with climate change, but it's maybe the most important climate change legislation that's been passed in U.S. history. For the Department of Agriculture, there is $40 billion of investments that we can make in rural America, $20 billion for on-farm conservation, another $13 billion to help transition rural energy systems, and over $10 billion to work on forest health and to reduce the risk of losses with climate change from forests. So we have resources from Congress within the Inflation Reduction Act. In addition, we have this new capacity through the Partnerships for Climate Smart Commodities. And I want to talk a little bit about what that is, because it's a brand new concept. And as we move forward, we're going to be sharing this with the rest of the world. We were, in fact, just literally weeks ago, we visited with the FAO and the OECD to describe to them what we're up to, because in many ways, what we're doing is new and novel. At the core of this program is the belief that the public cares about climate change and consumers are willing to put their money where their mouths are. So they are willing to pay a little bit more for commodities that are produced in a climate friendly or climate smart way. And the goal of this whole enterprise is to be able to translate that back to value added commodity production for producers across the US. It's a big experiment. We are investing over $3 billion, and the private sector is investing over $1.5 billion in this enterprise across 70 projects, across every state and every major commodity, including pork and beef and dairy and poultry. Each of these projects at its core will have four components. One is to provide incentives to farmers to help them transition to a more climate-friendly and greenhouse gas-friendly system. Measurement, monitoring, and verification of those practices so we're confident in those benefits. And that's critical because if we expect a consumer to pay for the benefit, we have to be able to demonstrate convincingly that those benefits are real. And so a lot of emphasis on measurement, monitoring, verification, an emphasis on research and innovation. So we want to test new technologies, new practices. And then finally, each project has to have its own marketing strategy. How are they going to convert this climate smart cotton or climate smart pork into a product that consumers want to buy? All of this is new and different and novel. So another part of our program will be what we're calling the learning network. And every project will be part of this learning network. And over the 5 years of this project, we will be wringing every ounce of information out of these projects we can get. We will be meeting quarterly with our partners. We will be asking them for data and information. We will be writing reports that we'll make available on what we learn about monitoring systems, models that can quantify carbon or greenhouse gases, how marketing is working, what consumer preferences are, and how strong consumer demand is, and how we can do the technical assistance to farmers in a way that works for them. So we're really excited about this program. It's a really exciting time to be at USDA working on it. I also wanted to talk briefly about adaptation because, you know, what I like to tell farmers when I talk to them about climate change is you're on the receiving end of climate change. You're affected, you know, farmers more than anyone are affected by extreme weather events and changing climate conditions. And that's true certainly for crop producers, but it's also true for livestock producers as well. And we are working through our network of regional climate hubs to provide information to farmers on how to become more resilient, how to improve soil health and improve resource health, how to manage livestock so they don't get overheated, how to manage water on the farm in a more efficient way, all practical things that we can do to help farmers not just mitigate greenhouse gas emissions, but also make their farms more resilient to the changes in climate that we're seeing. We don't have all the answers. And in fact, research and innovation is critical. And you're going to be hearing a lot about that from the Department of Agriculture this week. We've launched with the United Arab Emirates a program called Aim for Climate. You may have heard of it. At that core is that we think we can leverage additional financing to spur innovation across the agricultural sector. One area that we're particularly interested in for livestock is to come up with solutions for addressing emissions from enteric fermentation. These are the emissions from ruminant animals, very difficult to control, very difficult to contain, but there are novel and new technologies that are emerging. What we hope to do is to collaborate internationally on that research, because it's not enough to have a feed additive that can reduce methane emissions. You need to know that it's safe, effective, and also safe for the environment. And then on top of that, you have to ensure that when you're using it in a country, that it doesn't hurt you in export markets. And so other governments also need to be thinking about those same technologies in a similar way. And so there's a really strong incentive on things like feed additives to collaborate on the research. So as we move forward in implementing these technologies, we're moving forward together, and there's confidence in the benefits and the safety of these products. and there's not barriers internationally to using them. And so that's one tangible example of the work we're doing through AIM for Climate. And then finally, on the international engagement side, everything we're doing, we want to share with the world. There's so much to do and so short a time to do it that we want to make sure our research is available. We want to make sure that the information that's coming out through our regional climate hubs is available, and that we're going to be working with the institutions, whether it be AIM for Climate or the Global Research Alliance on Agricultural Greenhouse Gases, to share this information as we learn it. So Ashley, hopefully I didn't take up too much time. But hopefully we'll have time for questions because there's a lot happening.
I think we'll keep these up, this one. Well, what a perfect setup too for Laura, who is engagement specialist at ILRI. Oh, I can give you this one if you need it. But the importance of research, right, in this whole conversation around sustainability. Obviously, we can't implement practices if we don't know that they are in fact helpful. So tell us a little bit more about the research. ILRI is a
thank you. Not sure what's happening there. Thank you so much. Coming from an African context, I will say, Madam Moderator, thank you for the introduction. My name is Laura Kramer. I work with the International Livestock Research Institute. We're based in Kenya, and we have another headquarters in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia as well. And we are a research for development organization. So really bridging that divide between basic research and getting it out there. So working with other partners who can scale up, other national ag research systems, NGOs, and others who can take our research and bring it to scale. And what we really focus on is improving lives through livestock, because we realize that livestock are important. We aren't going to do away with them anytime soon. And they are critical for farmers in low and middle income countries. So we work on food and nutrition security through livestock, livestock value chains, reducing zoonotic diseases, animal health, and then also now climate change and its impacts on livestock and how livestock can be a climate solution. So here at COP, we've really organized ourselves around coming here to nuance this debate around livestock, because they can be vilified, like you started out the session saying. And so it's really nice to be in a room of like-minded people who also are on board with the idea that livestock are a climate solution. So it's nice to be among friends. So are the slides up? Okay, they're coming. So that was the introduction to livestock. So I'm just going, I have slides, sorry, we're a science organization. We're gonna bore you to death with a PowerPoint. Hopefully it won't be too boring though. Next slide, please. So, why should we care about livestock and climate change? I think the video was a nicer introduction. It talked a little bit about it. You also really highlighted that farmers are going to be impacted, and this is a critical issue for us. So, we know that the narratives can be dominated by the negatives, people blaming livestock for climate change, so much of the emissions coming from the livestock sector. My colleague Cynthia just sent me some photos this morning of some activists outside with banners saying we should all go vegan. That might be an option for some, but in so many low-income countries, it is just not feasible. And we actually need to increase consumption of meat, milk, and eggs in those places. So we want to change this narrative and really add nuance there. The livestock are just so critical. I'll focus on Africa. ILRI works mostly in Africa and Asia. So it's maybe a nice kind of complement to the rest of the panel here. In Africa, 55% of total household income in pastoral systems come from livestock. So when more than half of your income is coming from your animals, you need those animals to survive. in mixed crop and livestock systems, that figure is 35%. So a third of your household income coming from livestock. We need to be able to support that, and we need to be able to help those farmers adapt to livestock, to climate change. But like I said, climate change, and like was highlighted already, climate change is threatening those livelihoods and that nutrition. So we're, from research that we've done, in a high emission scenario, global cattle production losses from heat stress could reach up to $40 billion by 2085. And that's just huge. Under low emissions, it's $15 billion. And so we can't afford that. We need to look at these issues and be able to provide solutions and adaptation options. And then I'm living in Kenya. I've been there for 12 years now. It's become my home. We are entering the fifth year of drought. Livestock are dying by the millions in the Horn of Africa. And this is becoming a perennial issue. And we need to be doing more to solve that. So when we ask, if I ask you to think of livestock and to picture livestock, next slide, you might imagine something like this beautiful cow. you might maybe imagine a barn full of hundreds of them, you know, a milking shed, really churning out a lot of milk. So we have this tendency when we say livestock, we have this tendency to think about cows right away, especially in climate change discussions, because they're just so linked to the emissions. Depending on your background though, next slide, you might picture another beautiful animal like this. This is a zebu bull, I think from Kenya. And, you know, depending on where you're from, you might picture this, you might picture an Ankole cattle from Uganda with the huge horns, or Burana. So, you know, within cows and cattle themselves, there are many different species and breeds, or sorry, not species, but many different breeds. And so even within that, we need to expand our thinking there. And then in livestock in general, you know, we don't want to overlook all the other livestock that there are. So the pork, of course, you know, we've got a nice pig there, but the systems in the US are very different from, I think this is from Vietnam. We also need to remember that livestock aren't just about the milk, meat, and eggs, but they're also raised for fiber, for traction, and for transport in a lot of African countries. You see the donkeys there pulling the water. They're also used to take products to market. They're an important way to get around in rural areas of Africa where the road system isn't yet built. And then the other important thing that I think we also should keep in mind when we think about livestock is that livestock is a great way to build the empowerment of women and to include youth, because especially for African countries, as a young person, you maybe don't have your own land yet because you're still living with your parents, but you need to earn income. So raising rabbits, raising chickens, these are a way for the youth to be involved, to be earning income. And we know also based on our research around gender in livestock, that there are very different roles that men and women play in raising livestock, in owning livestock, and being able to make decisions around the income earned from livestock. So there are ways that we can work towards gender empowerment by working on livestock. Next. So there's a lot of terms that get used really frequently that I think can get conflated or can get kind of confused. And we want to really be able to talk clearly about what some of these terms mean and what they don't mean. So when we talk about livestock, as I said, we're not just talking about cows. We're talking about all of those things. So if we want to talk about reducing methane emissions, let's be very specific and talk about ruminants. You know, the monogastrics are not emitting, you know, they're maybe from their waste or from otherwise, but it's not the main source of methane emissions. When we talk about meat, we're not only talking about beef. There's the pork, there's chicken. And so we also can't confuse those items. And when we talk about meat, we're not only talking about protein. So I know we just had a video of Protein Pact. So I don't want to criticize the name of that initiative, but meat also has the micronutrients that are there, and it has cultural significance as well in a lot of places. When we talk about a sustainable diet, we can't only think about greenhouse gases. We also have to think about nutrition and making sure that people are meeting their own needs, and about aspects of water and other environmental aspects as well. And finally, intensification. I should have put sustainable intensification there, but it does not equate to industrialization. And I think in Africa, there's maybe a fear that if we intensify, it automatically means industrializing. But that's not the case. You can intensify your 1 acre of land and get more efficiency out of there without having confined animal feeding operations. So those are just some aspects to really think about and to make sure that we're all on the same page. So I think for systems in Africa, you know, it's not just about producing food that people are eating. Livestock play so many other roles, like I already mentioned, around transport, around plowing, and as part of mixed systems, you know, in Africa, fertilizer is very expensive and it's out of reach of most farmers. But in those mixed systems, their animals are producing the manure that is used as fertilizer. The crop residue is being fed to the animals, so you have a circular system. You're not losing as much nutrients, and ILRI is doing work to even tighten those systems more to prevent those nutrient losses. Marginal lands, and I think this is the case also in the US, where there are places that you would not produce crops. You just can't. Kenya, I know, is 80% arid and semi-arid. There's no way you're doing crop production on those lands. The only way that they can be productive is by having livestock there. And livestock has evolved through the pastoral systems to, you know, through millennia to be part of those environments. And they play really important roles on those grasslands and in those rangelands. And they turn what's there that is inedible for humans into what can be edible for humans. Plowing and transport, you know, the land sizes in some African countries are very small. You're not bringing in a humongous tractor to plow those lands. You need a way to plow those lands, and maybe a bull or a horse is the best option there. And so we need those animals around for that. They're also contributing to nutrition, like we talked about. And we know, I was talking with the Dairy Export Council earlier today, talking about how important eggs and milk are for young children. You know, it really makes a difference in their development. Just an egg a day as a small child can improve earning potential later in life. So those sorts of things are really, really critical. And then again, like I said at the beginning, the contribution to incomes is super important. And so, you know, they're so important. We can't get rid of livestock, and we need to help livestock keepers adapt to climate change. And those adaptation options within livestock especially have co-benefits, and so they can be climate solutions. A little bit about how context can vary. So not to criticize anyone in the US, but you know, the meat consumption in the US is over 400 kilograms per year per person, which is just quite high. And in some cases, maybe there can be some reduction there where possible. But in other places around the world, the meat consumption is minimal. In West Africa, the average consumption per person is about 35 kilos per year. And in Central Africa, it's 20 kilos per year. So when we hear this narrative around people need to reduce, people need to not eat that much meat, you know, we say, please, in other parts of the world, we need to actually increase, because it's so important. But that being said, there are future trends that we need to keep in mind. Population growth, urbanization, rising living standards, all are contributing to a growing demand. And it's estimated that by 2050, the demand for meat in Africa will triple. So how will we meet that? How will we meet that demand? We need to help producers to produce more efficiently and to adapt to climate change and protect their livelihoods. So, I mean, some of it was mentioned already, the issue of heat stress affecting cattle and affecting other livestock as well. The estimates for Africa are that by 2045, 10% of milk production and 20% of meat production will be affected by heat stress. There are areas that outdoor livestock keeping will just almost become impossible because of increasing temperatures. Temperatures in Africa are increasing faster than other areas, and it's a major problem. Feed quantity and quality. There's such an issue with seasonality, you know, during droughts, during even just dry seasons that aren't considered droughts, the feed is not enough and the cattle lose weight. They're emitting methane, they're not eating enough, but they're also not being productive. So we need to do a lot more work around these issues of the seasonality of feed. We're also having problems with expanding ranges of pests and diseases. Ticks, other things are expanding, going into areas where they weren't before. And so we need better systems to be able to give vaccines and to prevent those sorts of issues. And then, of course, all of this affects the food security and the income of the livestock keepers. So we need to work on all of this together. So what are some of the solutions that ILRI is working on and that we need to think about? ILRI itself is not doing that much breeding work. Breeding is very expensive and very long term, but we know that we do need animals that are more resistant to diseases, able to survive through drought periods. Working on the feed supply and seasonality issues, though, that is something that we are working on. We are helping farmers learn how to conserve feed, make silage, improve pastures with drought-tolerant forages. So those sorts of things are manageable, and we are working on those. And then also trying to match the feed supply with demand. So these issues of livestock feed markets, which can be difficult, but we're trying to work on that as well. Health and disease, rangeland management. We have a program that's working on participatory rangeland management. So communities come together and agree on rotational grazing and letting land rest and sharing those resources throughout the communities. Climate information systems. This is something that maybe where you're from is not an issue, but getting information on forecasts to livestock keepers is very difficult. And so we are working to improve the National Meteorology Agency's, their agro advisories for farmers, and getting that info out, you know, through digital innovations and things that weren't possible before, but now are becoming more possible. And then also trying to get finance to these farmers, because some of these practices aren't feasible to adopt without access to finance. And a lot of this can be done through empowering women, and working on these will lead to that empowerment. And just to end by saying, the cost of not acting is too high. We can't sit back and just watch this happen. We have to take action now in the forms of financing, and rolling out these technologies and scaling them up. And we have to do this for economies, for livelihoods, and for food and nutrition security. So thank you very much. And I look forward to the comments and discussion.
Well, thank you, Laura. Very much appreciate that message. And I guess if I could sum it up, what I learned there was, it can be very complicated. Livestock systems are very complicated. They're integrated with so much of communities, rural sociology, economics. And so things aren't nearly as simple as some people would like to believe. And I think that's our that's our task, right? As the livestock international community is to figure out how best to manage those decisions for each producer on the ground. And that's not easy. It takes a lot of time, takes a lot of effort. And so we very much appreciate, you know, your work. And so I think that highlights, you know, a big difference probably from what I presented and Bill probably to kind of the communities in which you work. And we're going to go to another part of the world as well, to Uruguay. And so we have, Gianni Matti. I had it down and I knew I was going to try to say it and then I would mess it up. Gianni Matta, head of innovation, scientific support for Uruguay's National Meat Institute. And so, I think it's exciting to see what's going on in your part of the world as well. And a whole different viewpoint than what I get to see, of course, in the States. And so I want to hear kind of what the efforts are going on in Uruguay and everything that you guys have going on.
Well, thank you very much for the introductions. And I'm going to go right up. I'm going to talk a little bit about the Uruguayan case I'm going to talk about our country for someone that are not familiar with it. So we are in South America, right? And we are right in between Brazil and Argentina. And I put here land endowment as a key feature for us. We have 5 hectares per person. And later on, I'm gonna talk about a little bit much about it. Just go back a little bit. Okay, so, and we have another salient feature that is, we have a very healthy rainfall rate. 1300 millimeters is a lot, and it's for many countries that it's a huge amount of rain. But also a little bit, we have a great GDP per capita, and also our energetic metrics, talking about energy, is 98% renewable, non-nuclear. So this is quite particular also for South America. Next, please. So what you might see here in these two pictures that we kind of seem a very small country in South America, but in reality, we are a middle-sized country. We have the average size of an European country. So in comparison with Texas, we are 3 times smaller than Texas, but we have almost the same cattle stock. So we have a lot of animals in our land. Next, please. So we are not a small country. We are unpopulated. We have a very low population, and most of our population is in the Atlantic area. So we are nearby the coast, and most of the country it's unpopulated. Next, please. So in terms of socioeconomical development, if you're not aware what's the Gini index, as the smaller the Gini index gets, the greater distribution of incomes you have. So you have more equality in your country. So we have the greatest GDP per capita in South America and the greatest GDP distribution. And also we have very salient results in Human Development Index, that it's an index for access to global health, years of schooling, and life expectancy. Next, please. But we're compared with South America, but where we want to go in the future? For sure, we want to go up in our GDP, and we have and had greater distribution, like New Zealand, French, Germany, and other countries. We all want to get more development and have a better society. Next, please. Well, many international agencies put us in a great space in terms of many areas like rule of law, democracy index, low corruptions. So also we have a lot of salient features related to South America. Next, please. And here comes the agribusiness. So agribusiness is very important for us because 75% of all our exports are related to the agribusiness. And we produce food for 40 million people. So we contribute a lot to what is food security. And agribusiness generates 1 in 6 employments in the country. And it implies 25% vertical in all our GDP. So agribusiness is very, very important for us. Next, please. So let's talk about our natural resources. I talked that we have 5 hectares per per person. This is very quite unique. And you can see here that not not many countries has that much land per person. And also we have a lot of water. So this is a great combination of factors to be a country that produces foods. Next, please. So in terms of the biome, our country shares the Pampa biomes with Argentina and Brazil. The difference is that we have 100% of our country, it's in the Pampa biome. Argentina and Brazil have many biomes in their own country. So, and the Pampa biome, it's mainly natural grasslands, as you can see. And most of our country is still natural grasslands. And the agriculture, it's all around the coastlands. And also we have laws that preserves the use of the soil. So we have laws that protect the use of the soil, and we have also a lot of natural grasslands, please. So this natural grasslands has a lot of biodiversity, more than 2,500 species of in the natural grasslands, and more than 800 species of vertebra that lives along with our livestock. Next, please. So most of our systems are pasture raised in natural grasslands in open range. Also, we have sheep production that is in mixed with our cattle production. And we have a lot of traditions in how we produce livestock. What about forest land? Well, we have a lot of also forest land, and we have an increasing amount of forestry, mainly because since the year 1987, we had a law that protects our natural forest. So since the year 2000, we are the only country that has increasing natural forests and also an increasing in commercial forests. And as you can see in the map, there's the forestry is well distributed around the country. But most of our forest, next please, it's this kind of forest. So most of the people thinks in South America, next please, the next image, yes. Most of our area are forests that surrounds rivers and creeks and has a very strong transition to our natural grasslands. Next, please. So what about our livestock? Well, our livestock is quite well distributed around the country. And also the sheep production, it's well distributed. We produce around 730,000 tons of all animal proteins, but most of it, it's beef production. Next, please. In terms of, we have 45,000 ranchers that in 12 million hectares, we have a great sanitary status that gives us the opportunity to be an export to many countries in the world. But we also have packing plants all around the country. So that gives a lot of jobs for the country. We produce 655,000 tons. And as you can see, we export most of it. And mainly our Chinese is China, NAFTA, EU, and Israel. And this bovine chain generates $3.3 billion a year. Next, please. So our stock is quite stable around the years. Our sheep stock has been declining, and right now it's been stabilizing. But we were able to increase our productivity. So we are, with the same stock, we are able to produce much more meat. And also we have many other opportunities like cattle exports. Next, please. Thanks. So how we did this increasing in productivity? Well, we reduced the average age of the steers, increasing much improvements in animal feeds. But we have a slow improvement in the reproductive performance of the cow-calf systems, mainly because they depend a lot on the weather. So when we have some droughts, the reproductive performance decreases. Next, please. So how much money we get for one animal and how it is distributed? So an average animal in Uruguay can generate $1,800. And this is the distribution around all the chains. So the main role for livestock is that generates a lot of labor. And this labor, it's in the rural areas. Then it comes the sector margins. This is for the cow-calf system, rearing, finishing, and also the packing plants margins. Then there is a lot of distribution in terms of fuels, supplements, freights, also, for example, broker fees, everything is here. But there's a lot of distribution in this chain. And also this generates a multiplier effect by 3x fold. This means that for every dollar that you generate for an animal, you multiply it by 3 in spillovers all around the chains. Next, please. So let's talk a little bit of our livestock environmental footprint. Because we are very export oriented and we produce a lot of food, our main source of GHG it's also the agriculture sector. But it's also the only sector in our country that sequestrates carbon. Next, please. But if you see in terms of the agriculture sector, enteric fermentation is the main source of our GHG emissions. And that accounts for mainly methane that comes 89% from the beef sector. So beef sector, it's a sector that we have to take care of a lot if we want to improve our GHG emissions. Next, please. So our country commit in the year in 2015, in the COP27, into global objective and then specific objectives. Why? Because we want to increase our GDP, but being more environmental friendly. So we commit to increase our GDP, decreasing the ratio of CO2 per GDP, methane, and out in N2O, and specific for the sector. So we made specific, let's say, commitments for the beef sector. Next, and we have until now we have a great achievement level, and this all of these commitments accounts for 99% of all our emissions. So we have a very big commitment. Next, please. So how we did that great, let's say, evolution of our efficiency in produced beef? We'll decrease our kilograms of methane per kilogram of beef on average, but we have a very, very high efficiency in the finishing system, but not so much in the cow-calf systems, but both of them improve. Next, please. So here's the thing. If we zoom in and we look at that we reduced 32% of the ratio of emissions of methane per kilogram of beef, we did it increasing on 30% of total methane, but we increased 90% of all beef production. This is how we did it. But we have to see what we have to do in the near future. So what will be the future challenges? And we talk a lot about here about genetics, additives, feed quality, reproductions, growth rate, sanitary improvements. So there's a lot of things that we can still do to still decrease. Next, please. So we create the livestock environmental footprint. The livestock ministry and the environment ministry with other agencies from the sector got together to try to create measuring systems that takes, and next, please. Not just GHG, but water use, GHG, biodiversity, soil use for the beef sector and for the dairy sector. So we got together more than 40 researchers for different agencies to try to develop a way to measure. And next, please. Yeah, it's okay. So just as a few examples of what we did, we created the ecosystem service indexes for all around the country. And what you can see as a very small example is that the livestock sector from the non-livestock sector inside our country has a greater ecosystem service index. But not just that, it has affect less the change. So if you have livestock in those areas, the ecosystem services negative tendency will be even less. Next, please. But in terms of enteric fermentation, CO2 equivalent, we were able to measure it inside the country, so we can know which areas are more efficient in terms of CO2 emissions per live weight or per hectare. Next, please. So it's not easy to let's say compare using only one metric. Because if we look at this chart, and well, they put us right up there, we make a specific measurement and we are quite over there, but this is only GHG. And we don't have to look at one metric, just one metric. Next, please. Because mainly if you reduce GHG, you're going to increase energy consumption, you're going to increase erosion rates in the soils, you're going to use more nitrogen, more phosphorus, and more pesticides. So this has to be to take into account when you are going to make plans of how to improve your environmental footprint. Next, please. So our country always based our systems in public goods. So our public goods are basically our main public goods is animal health. So we have an animal health system that it's public based, very strong. Food safety, also traceability about all our cattle. And we are thinking a public good in terms of environmental public good. And this has to contemplate not just the environmental part, but also the economic development of our country, the production of because we want to increase production, the environment, and we have to create more scenarios to see how the evolution of one scenario on another will impact in all the other sectors. So next, please. And just talking a little bit about public policy and sustainability, our country released a public bond that is related to our NDCs to decrease CO2 per GDP and to maintain or increase native forest. And this bond is for $1.5 billion. Next, please. So how did this works? For GHG, for example, if we comply with our international commitments, we won't pay more, more money for the bond. But if we are we have a better performance, you have a step down in the coupons. And if we have bad performance, we are going to pay more. And the same thing is for next phase, in terms for native forest maintenance. So if we have more than 103% of increase in native forest, we're gonna step down and pay a little bit less for our bonds. And if we have less than 100%, we're going to pay a little bit more. So this is kind of a commitment of, the commitment of our country that we are going to get there. So, and for closing, thank you.
Great job, and thank you so much. Those are pretty, you have some ambitious commitments in there and I think it's great to see some real thought behind how you get there, right? And bringing in all kinds of those pieces. And I guess one thing that I kind of took away too is how your country specifically really has honed in on the natural advantages that, you know, nature has given you, right? And so Laura, you mentioned it too, marginal lands, and then you showed a lot of native grasslands and of course ruminants are the perfect tool to have out there. So sometimes it's not a one thing or the other, right? Sometimes they have to be a match up to what you have. And I think that's an important thing for a lot of us here to take away as well. So thank you very much. So we are going to come to the screen now, and Max, I promise I will maybe step down here too. So, Max McAvazy, and he is the founder of Shangani Ranch. And so we're zooming back across the ocean now. He's also vice president. Well, I think I have that right. Vice president of Global Roundtable for Sustainable Beef, or board of directors member, at least I know that. An important part, and we wish you could be here today with us, but we know you have a lot to share about your part of the world as well. So happy to let you take it over, Max.
Okay. thank you very much, Ashley. Good to be talking to you. I'm sad as well that I couldn't be there. Throat's feeling a bit iffy, but not a problem. Just a quick point. You can hear me, I take it, properly?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, fine. So just a quick point. Shangani Holistic. I am the resident director of Shangani Holistic. I seem to have two different bios I see in there, or one bio they took different bits from. I'm the founder of Makera Cattle Company and eLivestock Global Traceability Systems. But thank you for having me here today and allowing me the opportunity to talk and to chat and to give a view of what I see in Africa, but more so in Southern Africa. I'm going to change slide. I hope that's going to change. Okay, the slide is.
Are you trying to advance the slide?
Yeah, it's. There we go. Right. So, first of all, before I go on to talk about this slide, I think it's important to understand, and I will concentrate on cattle throughout this speech, but I think we need to understand that cattle in Africa are not only used for beef. They have other roles which are also very important. I might repeat some of what was said before, and I apologize in advance for that, but, you know, it's used for plowing, which is a cultural part of when a lady gets married.
Token. Max, will you turn off your video? That way your sound might come. You're getting a little choppy. So if you turn off your video, that might help.
Sorry. I'm saying the bride price as well. So a father will receive cattle as a token, a thank you for having raised a daughter from the family that's she's marrying into. So cattle have quite a few benefits that are outside of the beef sector. We live in a place where we have to share resources. And this is the picture I took last year on our ranch, where I'm currently sat at the moment, about 3 kilometers from my office. And these are male elephants that use our ranch during the winter months. And we share them with the cattle, and we have no internal boundary fences, no internal fences on the ranch. And we work together with the livestock and the wildlife in harmony. We have giraffe, leopards, hyenas, etc. And we recognize the fact that we need to share the land from such a diverse position that we find ourselves in Africa. I hope it's changing. So there are three basic types of farmer which I will talk about. The first ones are what we call those on a commercial ranch. They are a very, very small part of the ranching population. I'd say, and Ilri would probably have the figures, they account for less than 5% of the total cattle population of Africa. But the one thing about them that they have advantage is they're well organized and run. They have the ability to plan operations based on the type of animal they wish to sell, whether they're selling steers, heifers, cow-cows, weaners. They have access to medicine and other inputs required with the ability to plan ahead. And unfortunately, generally have a large say in how the market is run. Where I currently sit right now, I'm running a herd of over 7,500 animals. And those are some of the bulls that we're using on our females there of Nguni type. What we're trying to do is preserve local genetics as opposed to going big in or Brahman. We're trying to keep the local genetics that have been roaming around for thousands and thousands of years. The second type of farmer we have in Africa is what I call the organized communal farmer. And the organized communal farmer is generally well organized. They manage shared resources like cattle handling facilities and paddocks. And what they generally need is guidance. They're not looking for handouts. They just need to be helped to do what it is they want to do better. And again, as I always say, they've been doing it for centuries. I remember at a conference in Chicago a few years ago, the GRSB, I shared a stage with an Irish farmer and a Canadian farmer, and they were talking about how they were second and third generation farmers and how things were tough and so on and so forth. And when I got up there, I said to them, guys, I beat you because I'm probably a 22nd or 23rd generation farmer. Because my father herded cattle, my grandfather herded cattle, and all the people going back before them herded cattle. So these are the people we normally like to concentrate on as a starting point and then mushroom up to the third category of farmer, who is the less organized farmer. And these are the guys who we tend to look for to follow the system whereby something happens, we improve across another property or another area. They see what's happening and then they improve. And these farmers, I'll call them victims as well, because they're mainly reliant on government and donors for the well-being of their cattle and indeed their livelihoods. They do not have much skill in cattle rearing and do not see their cattle as a source of income or economic assets. In times of disease or drought, they will literally watch their cattle die without doing anything about it. So these are the hardest people to change. We do not need to leave anyone behind, and we'll take them along with us. So how do we do this? Systems for Africa. And I'm talking from a private sector, community-based type system. I'm purposely excluding the donor from the equation because I'm a private sector player, so I don't want to speak on their behalf. The solution for me is knowledge. And it's about knowledge exchange. In the past, what's happened is a lot of projects that people have done with farmers, trying to bring farmers into using their cattle correctly and regarding them as income generating assets, has gone around the whole capacity building where the person with the money dictates to the farmer what they should be doing in terms of projects. That's changed. The best solution is through knowledge exchange. And that works because of simple things like, as I explained before, you know, you could be a 10th generation, 20th generation cattle farmer, and there are things which were done by your ancestors, which may not have been documented, but some of that knowledge we're taking back through our ethnovet in our research department. And we're looking at certain types of plants which are used for deworming, which have been used traditionally for years. We're putting them under a microscope, we're putting them in the lab, and we're seeing what benefit could those have for us as commercial farmers? And also, can we synthesize it and bring it more to the people, being natural products, and help improve the health of their animals? So just to go through just briefly, last week we were able to hand over some bulls to some farmers. And we trained them in holistic management principles, rangeland management. We trained them in cattle rearing. We trained them in what we call primary animal healthcare disease detection. And one of the biggest things you'll find is there's a lot of knowledge from farmers of what the disease is. They understand that on day one, it will do this. On day two, it will do this. And by day seven, it will pass away. But they don't know what to do and they don't know what it is. So we talk to them in terms of primary animal healthcare and we teach them how to do it. And the picture at the bottom is one of the ladies who is a recipient she's going to be helping her communities, but making sure we work with our colleagues in the Ministry of Agriculture, because obviously certain veterinary regulations need to be kept. Again, some pictures in the bottom right, those are the bulls we handed over. But what we're trying to do is a lot of the problems in Africa stem from inbreeding, and it's something which hasn't quite been dealt with. And we found that by using indigenous animals, but doing selective breeding, we can actually, and I hope that Ilri will be getting into breeding at some stage, because I believe that this could be the solution, that we take our indigenous breeds from the Nguni in the Southern Africa, to the Ankolis, to the Borans. And we do the same thing that's been done in the West, where we select for the traits that we want and use that to improve our herds. The last thing I'm going to really talk about is data. One of the biggest problems we have within Africa is there's not enough data about the cattle. And when we do a lot of our projects, we don't actually know, have we achieved the results we want or haven't we? A lot of reports are written. I've heard disturbing stories of rural cattle. We all know it's a work of fiction, but these are the stories that are going out without any form of verifiable data. So we need to try and get data not only to the world, but also to the farmer. We need to gather the data in an easy manner. We need to analyze it and it must be relevant, and it must go back to the farmer through various methods of dissemination. WhatsApp is a great thing. I think you'll find that in Africa. I will speak specifically Zimbabwe, but I do believe that everybody in Zimbabwe has access to WhatsApp, whether it's on their phone or not. They do have access in the middle of nowhere to WhatsApp. They can go and ask a neighbor to use their phone to get hold of one of their relatives and help them. So basically talking about this and asking the question, where do we go? What's the way forward for Africa? 2050 is often talked about. There's going to be a massive need for protein. 2050, the population of Africa is going to skyrocket. We need help and we need to build our resources. I admit I'm talking specifically about beef. I haven't forgotten about pork, Ashley, and I haven't forgotten about goats and other animals. But it is very important that we come up with something, because we do not want to find ourselves in a situation where in years to come, we'll go from barely being able to feed ourselves to mass starvation. We really don't need that. And to do that, the first thing is I'm going to ask the world is no handouts. Answers. Wonderful looking at what Uruguay is doing. Help us replicate your tech. Help us achieve the same result. To us, just I often say this, eat at the table. Statistic is that they talk 20% of the world's cattle reside in Africa, but we contribute to a very small percentage of total beef consumption. Now, another figure that I read on Twitter being bandied around at COP27 is Africa accounts for 4% of greenhouse gases. Now, if the United States of America can be producing more beef now than it was in 1974 with fewer cattle, what stops us doing the same? So we're saying, please give us a seat at the table and let's have partnerships. I'm happy, we are all happy with the work that USDA is doing, and we hope that it'll trickle down to the small scale farmers who need a chance on this planet. Because at the end of the day, all we really want is productive farmers. And when we have productive farmers, we have efficient people who can be in charge of their livelihoods. Thank you very much.
Well, thanks, Max. Bill, you wanna join me back up here? We can, we are doing great on time. So thank you to all the panelists for doing a great job with the presentations. And I think there's a lot shared there. Max, too, I took away that, and I'd say similar, this is kind of a theme of the panel is kind of adapting to the environment that we've been given, right? And so looking at the right breeds of cattle, Laura, you mentioned it, and Max honed in on it, too. And then how do we really see an improvement in implementation and change and continuous improvement? And I think Max hit on it as well, and Bill, you did, too, as well. You know, the sharing of knowledge, right? The learning network that you guys have incorporated into the grants too is a key feature, because I'd say one thing that I've learned in agriculture growing up in it and being in it my whole life is that farmers and ranchers across the world, they want to learn from their peers and they don't want to, you know, just be told or as Max said, kind of be given a handout and told exactly what to do. They really do want to learn and understand and adapt it to their operation, which can have very different goals from one place to the next. So, if you have a question, I think we have one extra mic up here, or we have two mics up here and maybe one more. So if you have a question, make sure you give us a little signal here, but I'll just kick it off with a question for, Bill, let's dive into climate smart grants here quickly and what you hope to achieve as far as continuous improvement and impact, total impact, and how you see that. And gosh, why is the secretary so excited about it, I guess?
Sure. Thanks, Ashley. There's a lot in there. I mean, part of it is that to be sustainable in terms of mitigating greenhouse gas emissions, farmers have to see opportunity, right? And so in the short run, we can create programs where the US government would pay farmers to implement practices. But ultimately, if we're going to transform the sector, we want that economic system to be sustainable. And so the exciting part of this initiative for me is that it brings consumers into the tent, that it helps connect them to farmers and the way farming is done, and it helps reward farmers through consumer demand for the types of practices that they hope to see. So I think it accomplishes several things. One is it can bring farmers and consumers together. It can help tie that connection, and it can also reinforce these practices and provide an economic incentive to continue them when we step out of the way, which, you know, eventually we will. And so we think that there's a model here that we can, you know, the as a policy that can be translated to other countries and other systems.
So basically, that's okay. So the coupon was mainly looking at our trajectories and really commit, and we are kind of serious and knowing that we are going to get there, and that's why we put that sustainable bond, because we know that we can get there and even get better. If we get better, we are going to pay less for those bonds. So it's even better for our countries if we improve our environmental performance. So that's kind of a strategy for us, for ourselves, to get better in to get better that decrease in the share that you're going to pay might be could be put into more sustainable areas. It will be a good virtuous circle to save that money and put it again in the system.
Yeah, I think both of them have just some amazing qualities that we can glean that might be replicable, you know, in being adaptable in different settings. Laura, for you, and then Max, for you as well, I'll come back to something that you said. And again, raise your hand if anybody does have a question here, and we'll get the mic to you. But which is, I feel like we have come in this point of the world to an either or, you know, one type of production or the other. And I guess I feel like that's a false choice almost, and to think about the integration and utilizing the land that best fits it, right, in the type of production. And so I just want to get your take on it. And Max, you as well, that same question.
Thanks for that question. Yeah, I think it goes back to kind of the reason that Ilrie came to this COP to expand the discussion and get people to think beyond just the bads that are caused by livestock and say, you know, there are goods from livestock as well. And, you know, the systems that we have in Africa, they really can't be put into boxes. You know, we can't say that we can only work on adaptation here and we have to work on only mitigation here. That's another thing that, you know, to me is kind of a false dichotomy. I think in the negotiations, they're negotiated different ways. But when you go to a farmer and the farmer has planted several trees, are those trees for adaptation and these trees for mitigation? You can't divide it like that, you know? So I think also for livestock keeping, we have to look at the systems as a whole. And you know, the mixed systems are different from the pastoral systems and even the agro-pastoral systems. But, you know, just recognizing that diversity and knowing that farmers are doing the best they can with their local resources And they're adapting on their own as well. And that's one thing kind of when I was listening to Max, I wanted to bring up that ILRI is also identifying local pioneers who already are adapting. They're doing what is, you know, it's community-based breeding, really. They are identifying those breeds that are more hardy and they are trying to mix them. And so we're looking at the people who are doing that and saying, let's help you share that information with your fellow farmers, you know, with the rest in your community, with the communities nearby. And so that to us is something also really important to support, to recognize that it's not just scientists who are coming with all the answers, but to look out and say, you guys have the answers too. Let's help you share those with each other and understand why they're working and then help bring them to others. I hope that answered the question. Thanks.
yeah, just jumping in, I think it's been mostly answered. Thank you very much for that, Laura. But I think, you know, I'm the last person who anyone would expect to say what I'm about to say is, let's look at land use over the last few thousand years. I think, you know, we're trying to work on a method here on the ranch here and with the communities in Zimbabwe, which we hope to spread to, which we've already started, is what happened all those years ago. I mean, if you think about it, pre-colonial times, there were cattle, there were wildlife, and they, whilst they may not have lived in harmony, they did coexist. And what's happening now is we're now being told that that's not such a great thing in terms of, and I say this, you know, in all honesty, we're being the world. One minister, as after industrialization, and in this, being told no. So I think we do have the into consideration when a lot of these decisions are being made in areas that we don't participate.
Well, Max, you cut out there a little bit, but we kind of heard your message, I think, loud and clear there. And I know we are getting close to time, but we do want to get a question too from the audience. So go ahead.
Thanks for the great presentations. My name's Macaulay Jones from the World Farmers Organization. Just a question for the floor. What do you think could and should be done to improve the transfer of both knowledge and technology between farming systems across the world?
So that's a great question. And that's one of the things that... there's a big challenge in terms of connecting the science that it's been done, it has been proven that it can improve the environmental footprint and transfer it to the farmers, mainly because always farmers are looking like, depending on the farmer, it's like to produce food for their family in many cases, and other cases it's just trying to, let's say, get a living on it. So when you're trying to tell them just this is for the environment, you have to get them like another chance to say, and this is good for you too. So that might be one of the things that you have to take into account when you engage farmers and trying to transfer technology to them for their better, economically, socially, and sustainably. The three things that we are talking right now.
Yeah, it's a great question, and it's a critical one to be successful. I did mention there's a lot that we're learning that we want to share. I think the other point about U.S. agriculture is that it's not a monolith, and animal agriculture is not a monolith within the United States. And there are producers that share many of the similar production systems, grazing systems, pastoral systems, organic systems. We find that oftentimes the most effective communicators are other farmers. And so peer-to-peer learning, having farmers share information, having practical field days where you can demonstrate these activities in practice can be very effective. How do you do that globally? Well, you have to be able to scale it up, and you have to be able to train the folks that will be working in the field. One of the challenges we have within USDA is we do have a tremendous footprint across the country, but our technicians aren't necessarily, they don't understand how to talk about climate change and how to understand what the threats and risks are. And so we're undertaking a very aggressive effort to improve the climate literacy of our workforce. We should be thinking about that globally as well. You know, who are the trusted sources of information? And how do you ensure that when they're talking to farmers, they understand climate risks and vulnerabilities and mitigation strategies and ways that can be effective?
Thanks. You know, it's interesting. I was saying how contexts vary, but it's striking how similar some of our challenges are, you know. So the same thing of trying to improve extension, you know, African extension systems do have their challenges in general, but the ones that are the extension agents that are there do need support on knowing more about climate, what are the adaptation options. So I would say, you know, going through the public extension systems. There's also private extension that is coming up more and more. There's a TV show in East Africa called Shamba Shape Up, Shamba meaning farm or garden. And it airs, I think, in Kenya and Uganda, and I think Tanzania. It reaches 8 million viewers every week. And it's a farm makeover show where they go to a farm, they look at the challenges that farmer is having, and then they do little things that can help the farmer improve. So that's a great program. It's rolling out in Zambia soon, and hopefully maybe soon in Zimbabwe also, Max. So you might be able to get it there as well. So going through things like that, these mass media things. And then also Max brought up WhatsApp and other kind of, you know, phone-based opportunities. I would say that's also really critical. Just sharing that information and being able to reach out, I think, is really important.
Sorry, if I could just add at the end, I think the important thing also is relevance. A lot of data that comes out when you talk about kgs of carbon dioxide is irrelevant to your smallest farmers. I think maybe denominator, the smallholder farmer who perhaps doesn't have a PhD in climate change, but they can understand what they're seeing, you'll reach a larger number of people as opposed to the whole top-down method that seems to be prevalent. If you want to engage with technology, the farmer at the very bottom has to be able to understand it. Thank you.
So I'm just going to make a final brief comment. So many excellent things came out in this session, and I just hope that we all, I know we all have a desire to be part of the market, and I think we can be together as producers from all over the world, Africa, Asia, Latin America. The rich data and the example of Uruguay is incredible, and also these great things happening in Africa with the farm makeover. So just as a call to share together, because this whole sector is under attack. And we have to come together and think about the farmers and then also the livestock and the planet. So we have a lot of resources to share, and ICA can also be a bridge to help share and to connect stories and training and experience. So thank you. Thank you again for coming today.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you to the panelists. Thank you, Max, for sticking with us and zooming in.
Thank you very much.